Hello Bhargavi, namaste.
Hi Apurva, how are you?
I'm doing good. How are you?
All good, yeah, all good.
Welcome to my conversation series, and I'm really delighted that you have joined me today.
Thank you for having me.
So today's guest is Bhargavi Venkatram, who is a very well-known vocalist in Carnatic music. So I'm so happy that we've got an opportunity to speak to her about her musical journey. And so Bhargavi, tell us, what made you choose music as your path?
Okay, so this is a slightly it's a slightly long answer. Okay, you have to bear with me. So it goes back to my childhood. My parents are musicians. My dad, H. K. Venkatram, is a violinist. My mother, Triveni Sarlaya, is a vocalist. She and my aunt, Kavita, sing together. My grandfather was a violinist, my dad's dad, and my grandmother, my mother's mother, is a dancer. So I was born into the arts, if I may say so. And I think I didn't have a choice back then, because I lived in this joint family where, we had the music school at home, and my grandfather would be teaching his students, and we used to have regular concerts at home. So it was a very, pervasive atmosphere, if I may say so. So I didn't really have a choice, and which is what made me dislike it. So believe it or not, I mean, today I'm a full-time Carnatic musician, but back then I used to hate Carnatic music because it was all around. I didn't have a choice. And, I just didn't like it at all. And I was dragged to my parents' concerts, whether I wanted to go or not. I didn't have a choice. And that's what actually made me take to dance. So I learned Bharatnatyam for a very long time, 10 years. Obviously my grandmother's influence, she said, okay, why don't you learn dance? If you're so averse to learning music, maybe you should, try learning dance. So that's what I did. I learned Bharatnatyam for a good 10 years, finished a couple of margams. And I don't know, somewhere through that process, even though I didn't enjoy music as much, if there was one person's music that I really enjoyed and loved, it was my gurus, TM Krishna's. So he had actually, I'd heard him perform, when I was 4 or 5 years old. And I remember telling my mother, I said, I really like this guy. I really like his music. And, back then I was a kid. I mean, what do I know? But so his music is something, every December in Chennai, there's that music season that goes on. I used to go and attend all his concerts. And I was a big fan, even though I didn't enjoy listening to anyone else's music, his music was something I was always drawn to. So this one year when I went, so my mom and aunt were touring the US and I went with them, and we were in Cleveland, and Krishna and I was also there. My mother told him, she said, see, she's a big fan of yours. She hates music, but your music she listens to. And she said, why don't you tell her to learn? She doesn't want to learn. And so he said, Bhargavi, you learn one varnam and you come to me, I'll teach you. If I teach you, will you learn? And then I said, yes, of course. So he said, okay, learn one varnam and come back to me. So he told me that when I was much younger, but it took me a long time, to actually get to that point because I was busy with dance and everything. And finally, I don't know, I think one day I was learning Baro Krishnaya in dance class. And I said, God, what a beautiful song. And I said, I want to learn how to sing this song. And so that's when I actually went and heard MLV Amma's famous recording. And I said, oh God, this is beautiful. Like, I want to be able to do this, And so I think that was the turning point. But of course, when I was a kid, when I was 2 or 3, I used to sit and recognize ragams. And, I just learned how to sing all the basics and varnams because my mother would be teaching and I'd just be fooling around. So in all honesty, that musical sense or that grounding was already there without my knowledge. I didn't know because I'd heard so much music. And so when I started learning, I said, okay, I'm going to learn one varnam, but I said, if I learn from anyone, it has to be Krishnana. So my parents spoke to him and he said, okay, let her come and sing for me. And let me hear her out, and if I think she's good, then she can start learning from me. So I remember being petrified, when I went to him and I sang for him and he said, okay, I'll teach you. So that's where it all started. But yeah, it's been quite a journey from not enjoying music at all to, you know, loving it. And as a profession, taking it up, I think I never thought of it as something that I would do full time. You know, I did my engineering because I was not sure. You know, I enjoyed computer science. And so my parents said, why don't you do your degree? And then you see, I mean, if you feel like music should take over at that point, then, you know, you can always allow it to take over. But it's better you finish your engineering and then make that decision. So I did my engineering and then I said, okay, I'll take a break for a year, do music full time, see how it goes. And I think I really enjoyed it. So it was just a very organic flow. It's not that, you know, I decided that, you know, this year of my life, I'm going to do this. And that year, it was very free flowing and just happened, I guess. So, yeah.
What are the qualities in your guru which really inspire you and which you feel that, okay, even I need to achieve this? Is there anything like that? I'm sure there'll be many things.
The list is endless. But I think one thing in his music that's very obvious for anyone who hears it is that he's one with the music. And, you know, he's one with the notes. And it's like, it's a free, you know, exploration of music. You know, it's like a blank canvas that he just paints on, you know, without any rules and regulations and restrictions. And it's just, music just flows and he enjoys every bit of what he does. And that's so evident, you know, and that I think is something that's really, you know, admirable. That is something that, you know, I would hope to get to one day where, you know, you're just free with your music. You can see that he's really, there's nothing that's holding him back from anything, you know, and nothing bothers him, whether it's the stage, the audiences, or, you know, his own mindset or his own state before the concert. Nothing. Once he's there, once he's singing, let me say, you know, it need not be in a concert, can be even otherwise. If he's singing, he's just one with the music. So I think that is something that I really, really, you know, aspire to have for myself. So yeah.
So I know that you have many concerts in a season. How is the life of a performer, basically? What has been your experience this far? I mean, you'd be juggling even your family life, and, you know, can you just tell us something about that? How has it been all these days?
Yeah, so I think the life of a performer, if I may say so, it's definitely a life that requires discipline. When I say discipline, I don't necessarily mean waking up at 6 a.m. Or, you know, having a timetable for everything. I don't mean in that sense. When I say it requires discipline, I mean a certain pattern that you follow in life, right? For example, now, you know, if you wake up in the morning and you do Akara Sadhana, and then, you know, all these things are sort of like, it becomes a part of your life, you know, when you've taken this up seriously and that's what you do. And before the concerts, you usually have a routine that you follow, you know, I probably drink a kashaya or something that soothes your throat, you know, there's small things like this. But I think that mindset of discipline, of having to be consistent with what you do, is something that's very important for a performing musician. And obviously, you know, like, if this is my profession full time, right? So whether it's learning new compositions, classes, all these things, you know, it's sort of, you put a routine in place that pretty much the good part is, actually, I forgot to mention, a lot of this is bound by the factor, like, you know, if you have a concert, then, you know, everything revolves around that, right? Like, your whole day revolves around it, or you plan according to that. But otherwise, you pretty much have the freedom to plan your day or your schedule the way you want to, right? For example, now, if I know I have something at 8 p.m., suppose I have to go out for dinner, for example, right? Then I have the freedom, because I'm my own boss, I have the freedom to say, okay, I'm going to finish whatever I need to do, whether it's practice, have class, whatever, before that time. So I can, you know, go out. So I guess it is all about how you manage your time. And it's nice to be your own boss. So, and you don't necessarily have anyone working under you. You work for yourself. So it's all up to you to put a schedule in place and to work around that. So, yeah.
Yeah. Can you tell us about any memorable concert experience of yours, which you feel was really unique?
Yeah, I think obviously when you ask me this question, quite a few concerts pop up in my mind. But the first concert I sang was obviously very memorable. And it was a very unique experience because I had obviously heard a lot of concerts, and to be actually sitting on stage and to, you know, look at the audience and, you know, to have to perform and to do well, that expectation, obviously, because for me, that's always been a thing, right? When I go on stage, I know that people in the audience have a certain expectation that I have to meet, right? And that was because of my parents and my guru. And so I guess that was a little, you know, overwhelming initially. But once I got on stage, it was a great experience. I think it was very, very memorable. I performed in Seshadripuram for their Ramnami celebrations. And yeah, that was a very interesting experience. Another very, very memorable concert was in 2020, just before the pandemic hit. I performed in Pune with my dad on the violin and with Van K. Arun Prakash on the mridangam. So performing with my dad and Arunana was a wonderful experience, especially for that crowd. So it was a massive audience. I had never performed such a huge crowd before, and it was a wonderful experience. So that was one such experience. And very recently I performed with Vidwan R.K. Shriram Kumar, Vidwan Arun Prakash, and Vidwan and Guru Prasad in Chennai. And these are three musicians who I've heard performing with my guru very often, you know, and I've been behind him putting tambura for him when he's performed with them, and I've grown up listening to them. So for me, that just, it felt very, very special. You know, I was very blessed to have that opportunity to perform with them after having heard them with him for so many years. It was a great experience. So yeah.
That's really nice. And this question, I'm sure everybody would be very curious to know the answers for. Which are your favorite ragas and why?
This is a very tough question. If you ask any musician, they will tell you this is a tough question, because
then I'm sure you'll be having
it keeps changing. Yeah, it keeps changing, you know. See, I'll tell you, like, I think really enjoying a raga happens either when you listen to someone's music and you hear a particular raga and it just touches your soul, right? That is something that is what makes you connect to a raga instantly. And the other thing is, obviously, now when you're practicing, you know, you get really involved in a raga and you, you know, you really fall for it. But I think if there's one raga that I absolutely adore for the longest time, it has to be Varali. Varali is my favorite, absolute favorite. I think that stems from the fact that I heard a lot of it, you know, early on. And I don't know, it's difficult to explain why I love it, but it just, that's my happy place. You know, when I, you know, there are obviously times when you feel drained out and you don't necessarily feel like singing or whatever, but that is one thing I'm always happy to sit and explore. So Varali is definitely my favorite.
Wow, that's awesome. That's nice to know. Okay, viewers, we'll take a short break. You can watch a clipping from Bhargavi's concert before we get back with our next set of questions. Shringa. So coming to the current situation that is COVID and concerts are being streamed online, what are your thoughts on this?
Obviously, you know, none of us expected this. Last year when the pandemic hit us, I think initially all of us were just sort of in shock and trying to just, you know, figure out, because staying at home, not going anywhere, all this was sort of unheard of for any of us, right? So it took a while, I think, for this online space to really be tapped into. And ever since, of course, now it's become, in the last 1 year, it's become very normal. There are concerts happening every day, lots of concerts happening. I think there are a few things that come to mind, you know, when I think of this big shift that's happened. One is we've obviously been able to reach out to a lot of people, which is a great thing, you know, from across the globe. If I was, you know, normally if I was performing in a particular place, then only the people who came there could listen to the concert. But now, sitting, you know, the comfort of their homes across the globe, they can listen to concerts that happen anywhere, right? So that I feel is one of the biggest positives that has come out of this whole online performance space. But I think definitely one thing that I believe should change or should slowly find a way, you know, at being better at it is the way organizations and, you know, online platforms monetize these performances for the artists, you know, because I feel like just like any other profession, you know, this also requires a lot of hard work, a lot of, you know, effort, time, energy, everything, right? Nothing comes easy to any of us. So I feel like finding a way to allow Rasikas from all over the world to enjoy the music, along with giving the artists their due, is something that all the organizations should really think about and find a way to work towards that. That's something I really hope happens soon.
So it has turned out to be quite advantageous also. Streaming concerts online.
Yeah, from definitely. What I understand. Definitely because like I said, your reach is so much more, and you know, that is something that is definitely a big, big advantage. Yeah.
Tell us about how music has actually influenced your personality and you as a person.
Okay, so I think what music naturally does to you is makes you a person who thinks, right? Because, you know, obviously music requires, it's not like writing an exam, you know, you study a few chapters and you go write and you get the marks, and it's pretty straightforward, if I may say so, right? But music is not that straightforward. It's not that black and white. You know, there will be days, for example, where, you know, I may have practiced a lot. I may have worked really hard, you know, say for a competition, just giving you an example. Suppose I've worked really hard for the competition and I go and I sing and I think I've done well, but I don't win, you know. That really teaches you a lot, because it teaches you how to deal with failure. It teaches you, you know, how to become a stronger person. And that sort of preps you for life, right? Because not everything is going to go your way all the time, obviously. There are going to be a lot of things that don't go the way you want them to. And if you believe that, you know, you can pick yourself up from that situation and move on, which is what you do, right? Now, if I lost a competition, I mean, I have to learn to pick myself up because this is what I love doing. I'm not going to just leave it hanging midair. I have to get back to it. So how do I pick myself up? You know, those are lessons that very subconsciously you learn. You know, it's not that, you know, I lost a competition. I picked myself up and I moved on. And it's not that I consciously think of it when I'm at a low point in my life, right? When I'm at a low point, something subconsciously, because that emotion has been felt before through music. So that is something, it teaches you a lot, and it teaches you patience, because there are days when you will practice the same thing for days together and you will not get it. You know, you can keep singing the same thing 200 times and you will not get it. So you just have to learn to be patient, right? So that is something that it teaches you as well. So a lot of valuable life lessons.
Bhargavi, everybody is aware that you hail from a family of musicians. So how have your parents actually influenced you?
So my parents have obviously been my biggest support system, you know, and I think they've been the most perfect parents in the department of my musical journey, especially because, you know, when I didn't enjoy singing, I can never remember a time when, you know, they forced me to sit down and learn and, you know, stuffed it down my throat. They never did that. You know, of course, they would take me for concerts and everything, but never forced me to do something that I didn't want to do, which is what I think led me to this path many years later. Because if they had forced me to learn, I may have completely turned away from it and hated it altogether. And, you know, never pursued it. So that is something that I really have to give them credit for. Apart from that, of course, you know, ever since I took it up seriously, they have been my backbones. I mean, my mother, you know, I literally run to her every other day and say, teach me this song, teach me that song. You know, what do you think of this? What do you think of that? And like, she's always there. My dad is like, he takes class for me all the time. You know, like I sit with him and we practice together and he gives me a lot of tips on Manodharma Sangeeta, on how to, you know, elaborate on a raga, you know, what are the things I can do? How do I be creative in terms of niravel, swaram, whatever. He's been completely, you know, my backbone in that department. So I think these guys, both of them have just, they've also been very strong and strict critics of my music. You know, after every concert, obviously, you know, they're both musicians, so they understand that right after the concert you don't sit and, you know, have like an intense discussion, because you need to cool off and, you know, get your mind off it. But, you know, after like a day or two, they'll slowly, you know, tell me, this was not okay, this is what you need to improve on. So that obviously has helped me grow a lot. You know, the constant feedback, the constant support, that is something that's been invaluable. And I mean, no words will be enough for me to thank them for everything they've done for me, musically and otherwise. So yeah, they've been my biggest pillars of support.
That's really nice. And we know that you recently got married to somebody who was in a totally different field. What was the thought behind this, basically? And I'm sure everybody is curious about this.
Yeah, a lot of people have actually asked me this question. I think because I grew up with, you know, musicians in my family and, you know, everyone was sort of involved in the arts, I've always had that environment and that cushioning at home, you know, and that's excellent in a lot of ways. But I also feel that it's important to have people in your life who are not involved with this field, you know, because a lot of times simple things like, you know, dinner table conversations, whether we talk about books, travel, movies, whatever we talk about, it always comes back to Carnatic music, you know. And I mean, it's wonderful in many ways, but I'm the kind of person who enjoys different things in life, you know. I like having a life. I like going out. I like traveling. You know, I enjoy meeting people who don't do what I do, because the kind of conversations you have with them are so much, you have so much to learn from them. Because, you know, if you're constantly in your zone thinking only about what you do, then your worldview is pretty much restricted. So I've always been the kind of person who enjoys that. And I have a lot of friends, actually most of my friends don't know anything about music. A lot of them have started listening to music and, you know, all of that after they got to know me. And I mean, of course, all of that is there, but a lot of my very close friends have no idea, you know, and they sometimes just come to my concerts because I'm singing and they want to be there for me, you know. So I think I really wanted that in my life. So, you know, when I thought of marriage and, you know, spending the rest of my life with someone, I think my first instinct was that I don't want to marry a musician because, you know, I have a family full of musicians who obviously, you know, like that support is important for me. But since I already have that, what I would ideally want, you know, was to have someone who had nothing to do with it. So it gave me a fresh perspective, even musically, to be honest. Because, you know, sometimes I may be singing something and obviously people who know music will relate to it and whatever. But someone who knows nothing about it may be able to give me a fresh perspective. So that is sort of what made me, you know, decide that I don't want to marry a musician. And so this was obviously, you know, my parents, I gave them the responsibility. I said, look, I don't want to marry a musician. And so it's up to you. I mean, I think you should find me a partner who is going to encourage me, you know, and that is something that's very important. And I think I've been very lucky to have found someone who obviously encourages me to do whatever I want to do, but also gives me that space. Because, you know, right after a concert, obviously you're tired and like everyone else is giving you suggestions on what else you could have done, like my parents and everything. But, you know, my husband knows nothing about it. So, you know, that just makes for an easy conversation, right? And it's just, it's relaxed. And so that is something that I really value. And yeah, I think the most important thing in any relationship is obviously understanding. So it's important for him to understand my journey. And, you know, on, like, for example, on concert days, I literally will not talk to him the entire day. And, you know, I'll be zoned out in my own zone. And so it requires some level of understanding. So I think if the other person's understanding and they understand why you do what you do and why you enjoy doing what you do, I think that is more than enough. So, yeah, that's pretty much why I did that.
What do you think is the goal of Carnatic music? Okay, music in general. What do you feel is the goal, the ultimate goal?
For me? Personally?
Yeah, personally, your goal. That's what I'm asking.
Personally, I think what happens when you're a performer is you tend to get pretty, you know, bogged down, if I may say, with all the different aspects that, you know, involve the performance itself, right? Like, I mean, when I go and sing a concert on stage, obviously I may enjoy the music, but I'm obviously thinking about the audience. I'm thinking about, you know, I'm thinking about whether I'm singing it right, about whether I'm reaching out to them the way I want, the way I want them to perceive my music. There are a lot of things. And about, you know, my rapport with my co-musicians. There are a lot of things that you think about, right? And what happens when you're a performer is this aspect, of course, and also about getting opportunities, about doing well, about, you know, moving forward. So a lot of times there's so much of this happening that your personal equation with just the music, you and the music itself, you don't get enough time, if I may say so, or you don't get enough personal space with you and your music. I don't know if that's making sense, but, you know, you do need, like, that's something that is my true goal, honestly, to be able to be one with my music and just nothing else around that should bother me or come in the way. And just, I should be able to enjoy the purity of every note, you know, that I'm singing or listening to, whatever it may be. So that, I think, obviously will come over time. You know, when you're young, all these things tend to you know, obviously take up your time. And I think once you get a little older, you can sort of just, I don't know, focus on you and the music without having to worry about a lot of the other things that you otherwise will have to worry about. So yeah.
So do you have any message for students who want to pursue music as their profession and to people in the music field in general? You would like to convey something
to them? The music field, I mean, I'm part of it. I mean, we're a whole community of musicians. But I think to students of music, if I can give them one piece of advice to the, you know, little kids who are learning music, I think keep learning. It's obviously not easy. You will hit a lot of roadblocks and you will, you know, have moments where you feel like, God, I'm done with this. Like, it's too hard. I can't do it. Don't give up. You know, it's, there's always something to learn and there's always something to look forward to when it comes to music, you know, which makes it, you know, a learning process through your life. And that's something you can always hold on to irrespective of what you end up doing in life, right? The other thing I would really like to tell all of them is, I think before you decide to take this up as a full-time profession, I feel like making sure your education is solid in place, making sure, you know, an education is very important for anything. Like, for example, I may not be using my engineering degree today, but the fact that I'm an engineer and I have that ability to think analytically and to, you know, just break things down, figure out how I want to do it, all of that greatly helps my music as well, you know. And so I feel until you're 100% confident that this is what you want to do and this is the path you want to take, I feel that having a solid educational background is very, very essential. And it doesn't have to be in something that you hate doing, you know. You find something that you love studying. For example, it can be anything, you know. You may want to study geography, but you may love Carnatic music. My recommendation would be to get that degree, you know. Make sure you're qualified, because that gives you a different kind of freedom. And you're always free to, you know, choose to do this full time. But I feel that getting an education and, you know, having a degree is something that's very, very important. So that is something that I would encourage all youngsters to do.
That was a great message from you. And thank you so much, Bhargavi, for joining me today in this conversation. And I wish you all the best.
Thank you for having me.
You're most welcome. And I'm sure that everybody enjoyed this. I wish you all the very best in your musical journey. Thank you so much.
Thank you.